Some went in the mail, those who don't need renewals will get them shortly. Those who do need renewals, you know, it takes longer to attach a personal note and reminder about the need to pay to keep us in business. I'm proud to say that the first history of psychohistory, and I feel like I've been talking about forever, thinking of psychohistory, origins, controversy, controversy, pioneer contributors, is scheduled for release on Monday.
On Monday? Hey, early.
Well, they keep changing. It's not the hunt, and it isn't simply as on Amazon, the $140 for the hardcover.
Just convert back to 200, right?
Yeah, the 250. They are saying $44.95 for the paperback at Amazon, but it's $38.95. And if you go to the Routledge site, they assured me, because I had this dream of a $20 paperback. What did I know? They have 20 to 30% discounts regularly. And you find a lot of history. This is the cover of that case here, but find a book and see if it really the cover.
And there'll be a panel on the book at the ICA on Thursday, May 31st at 4 a.m. I saw you today about the time.
Slight problem. Don't tell Larry or he will come down from Harvard to discuss it. Wonderful news that Bob Lentz up in Calgary has returned to psychotherapy form as administrator and as well as book review and film review editor Cleo. Bob is such a phenomenal worker who never wants credit for anything that's not. That's a very valuable addition and will be a lot more organized. Our psychiatry listserv that I'm looking around, I don't see Brian and Ken will be on it occasionally. It's going to be revived with a moderator. Our big problem was the lack of consistency and not having a moderator. And so Bob doesn't want to be a moderator, and he's a very good judgment about keeping the group focused so that for both discussion, announcements in another section, and avoiding the type of controversies that drove a lot of people off the site that Molly, the listserv that Molly Castillo had started and done very nicely until it became too much, especially she gave her home number and people were chasing her at home. Molly is feeling lucky, I know she wanted to be here.
She injured herself.
Oh, injury.
Yeah, she broke her ankle.
She
broke her ankle.
There's a guy with a sore foot. I can empathize a lot. And our whole issue, which is covering the sexual violation and the awakening, if you want to comment on the symposium article, and other subjects, deadline has been extended to the end of May. So if you have something you want to send, to me. And upcoming in Cleo, we have a dialogue on Lincoln by Jim Anderson, previous presenter of Chicago, and Chuck Strozier, who's not only the most distinguished historian, but he's the author of two books on Lincoln, two psychohistorical books on Lincoln. And we're going to be welcoming both commentaries on their dialogue and independent articles on Lincoln and related subjects. The following special issue should be with Peter Petschauer as guest editor. He will be back from Europe next month, and it will be on trauma, a very wide definition. And we'll work out the call for papers shortly. Now, one last announcement on this list is Ken has proposed an interesting series of presentations on the future of psychohistory, in which we would invite Stoser, CUNY, and Larry Friedman, Harvard, and Joan Trott, and these two of their study, and the president of Wesleyan, who had done an interesting article on psychoanalysis, applied psychoanalysis involved, for other people to give presentations on an ongoing basis, and it will become the basis of the book. And,
right.
But the big question is, would our members want to come out for that sort of thing? Yeah, these are very distinguished people, and they're not, none of the four I mentioned are analysts per se, and, but would you want to be coming out to hear these people who have made certainly, the first two have made very major contributions to psychohistory.
Would it be like a Saturday?
Well, it would be usual Saturday.
If they have a major presentation, we'll have a few hour thing that would be.
Well, the usual presentation.
They would make it into a book.
We would make it into a book. Several things already published. We've elaborated on others with new material. So who here, I think you would come out because there's so many demands on our time, especially going in April, there are a million conferences. And
okay, yeah. Next April.
So it would be one presentation at a time.
Well,
So Michael Roth not only is the president of Wesleyan, he's the historian who organized the controversial Freud exhibition at the Library of Congress. And he's written a number of books on Freud.
So that's the issue. So, and if you're not comfortable saying one way or the other now, email me, because this is, well, we're always, the main goal is always to help the presenter. If people don't come, we're not doing enough company of a presenter, so Ken and I like to talk regardless of who's there, and we do a lot of that, but you get the idea. So please let me know, and we never know how many are coming. We have 31 at our last meeting, which was a record for the forum, since we aim for 12 to 18 people as our ideal size, with certain advantages that happen to work very well with the 31. Please do let me know one way or another. Okay, well, I've gone on for too long at this point, so let's start our usual way.
Can I just make a quick announcement?
Oh, yeah.
Right, okay, so it's less than 6 weeks before the IPA conference. And I have the latest newsletter here, especially if you're not an IPA member. Please be happy help yourself to one of them. Inside is a flyer for the conference. So if you get one of these newsletters, you'll have the flyer. And if you're a member and would like to help promote the conference, I have extra copies of the flyer. So please. Take a few.
I'll take two more.
Okay. And then if you can pass these to Paul, please. And if anybody will distribute them, like where you think people who might be interested can see it.
Well,
I'll put
them up for this one.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Here. Just take. Yeah. You don't need this. Excuse me?
When Bandy Lee's presenting?
Wednesday.
She's speaking Wednesday afternoon.
Yeah.
She won't be speaking on the dangerous case of Donald Trump. I'm sure there'll be questions for her on that. She'll be speaking on her research on violence. Is what she wants to speak.
What show will be there?
Pardon?
I will be there, but I'll come then Tuesday morning.
Oh, okay.
Reminder that Jacques Luna is our moderator, and Ina Rosenblatt is having the daughter's marriage next weekend. She's a little busy with that, but she kindly sent Evgenia here to videotape our proceedings so that members at a distance can view them online. And those will probably be better organized, I think, on our website as a result of Bob Lynch's activities. Now to the to our usual introduction, which is say who you are briefly and your question, if you have one, for Ken. I'm Paul Elovitz, historian, psych historian, psychoanalytically trained, presidential psychobiographer, interested in finding time and writing a book on the psychology of President Trump, recent American presidents, and some who also ran. My question for Ken is, how specifically is his paper psychohistorical, and how can we bring psychoanalysis and psychohistory into it?
My name is Tom Ferraro. It's an interesting paper because it's such a big, broad subject, you know, the nature of what it is to be human. So I thought basically two questions. One is just general question of kind of an evolutionary process. I was downstairs getting some coffee and I saw one of the posters. That's such interesting things here, right? One is on kind of like the values of the philosophy of the game, the gamer. And one of the subjects is, one of the titles of one of the games is The Last of Us. So the question I have for you is, do you think in some way that what we're going through now in terms of basically the electronic revolution and all of that is compromising humanity? Is it, are we at the next phase of an evolutionary step where computers will be more, they'll kind of take over or we'll be left behind? And the second question I have for you in the context of what it means to be human now, just want you to respond to the conversation that Mephistopheles had with God at the beginning of Faust, where the devil said that he was so amused at human beings, and he compared them to crickets with long legs, that they incessantly try to jump up, but they always mostly wind up back in the mud and the dirt and the worms kind of groveling around. So I just want you to respond to that metaphor of a human being as someone who's basically stuck in the misery, but occasionally tries to jump out of it.
By the way, Tom is a sports psychoanalyst, psychologist, and also a columnist.
Hi, morning everyone. I'm Marcy Houston. I teach up at SUNY Albany. I was actually hired to teach pre-law students in an affiliated program between New Albany and Albany Law School. So I have some background in law and also background in, you know, medicine. My doctor was at Sheffield in trauma, you know, studies. So, what question I have for you? Above and beyond the need to have a comprehensive study of what it means to be human, why do you want to examine what it means to be human? why is it relevant? Why do you think it's relevant?
I'm Brian D'Agostino. My background is in political psychology. I did doctoral research on the psychology of militarism, and that's how I got into psychohistory. And I'm a retired educator. I've spent my time writing. I wrote a book called The Middle Class Fights Back, How Progressive Movements Can Restore Democracy in America. And I'm currently working on a book that's entitled Nature and the Human Spirit, Creating a Future Without Illusions. I don't have a question. I've given Ken a whole bunch of questions.
Longer than this question.
So you wrote the book for me today.
I'm Joyce Rosenberg. I'm an analyst. I write for Cleo's and other journals and write about the impact of mostly about the impact of culture on practice or on our psyches. I also teach. What else? And my day job is in, totally different. It's in journalism. I write about small business. I don't have a question, but I would. I just don't know what it is.
Please go ahead. Introduce yourself, please. Should you introduce yourself, Chad?
Well, yeah.
Oh, you do? Okay.
Yeah, I read a speech about that.
Okay.
I want this.
Okay.
So please, yes or no?
Me next?
Yes, yes.
Well, should you root?
I'm Susan Saluda. I'm Jack's wife.
You don't count.
I just came to listen to Ken today, so.
Okay. So, can you tell us your name, please?
Okay.
Should it be root?
It doesn't matter.
Okay.
See, I see yourself. Commence yourself. I'm following you. Go ahead.
Okay.
I'm on ladies.
Yeah. I'm Candace Orcutt. I'm a clinical social worker and a psychoanalyst. I'm former associate of James Masterson. And I'm supposed to be retired, but in this business it doesn't happen. So at the moment I'm teaching and I'm preparing a presentation for the Masterson Group in South Africa this summer. In terms of a question, do you see value, as some people, I guess Freud was one of them, who saw an analogy between the developmental stages of the individual and the developmental stages of society? For instance, right now, in some ways, we seem to be a sort of worldwide two-year-old who has to divide everything between the good guys and the bad guys, has occasional temper tantrums, and is just learning to talk about it.
I'm Ruth Hittmeyer. I'm a psychologist, psychoanalyst. I have a private practice in Richmond, New Jersey. I'm faculty at the Center for Psychoanalysis and Psychotherapy of New Jersey. I present papers and write. The topic that I'm very interested in is culture, ethnicity, bilingualism, because of my own background. And I supervise students in the institute. I don't have a specific question for you, Tim, but a question that happens to me frequently, especially in the last year and a half, is how history repeats itself, and how history is like, I think it was Benedetta Croce, historian, that says that history is like a spiral repeating itself in some ways, even knowing the same way. And my concern and my thoughts are lately about we are going to the right all over the world again, you know, in Europe and well, here, obviously. And it's how difficult it is for humans to stay on track, to think of equality, to think of all the democratic ideas that we have, and how discrimination and violence is so prevalent.
Hey, would you introduce yourself, please?
Yeah, Marion Margulies. I'm new to the forum, and the topic is of interest to me. I don't have a question as of yet. I'm here just to learn and
I'm a psychologist, as a developmental psychologist originally, and have a private practice working with children and adults and on some groups. I'm interested in getting back to writing, which was my former career.
Okay. As the moderator, I encourage participation. Alas, you missed that earlier, we have a small group here today. You will want to speak, please raise your hand, and I'll call on you in the order that your hand goes up, okay? And we do this, we tolerate this because sometimes people have to monopolize the meeting by speaking too much. So if you want to make comments, whatever, please keep relatively brief and so we can go on. And that's all I'm going to say. As for myself, I'm a historian, psychoanalyst, and moderator. That's it. Then you begin, I can.
And Jack has read this paper 620 times just this week. Spent a few hours going through it.
Okay, since you said that, I'll say this to you. Your paper is truly profound. Wow. You mentioned so many human people. I'm going to tell you Pascal. I could go on. What do you think we'll come up with a humanist all over that transcends all these people? That's all.
So usually you have a certain amount of time, so is 4 hours good?
Could be 20 minutes would be better.
20 minutes. Okay, that's what I wanted to. Okay. So I'm still 10th week swimming. So there is another 10th week swimming running around, who was a pharmacist in New York. So I've been thinking about, I need to spend more time trying to figure out things about being ill. And I was at a interdisciplinary studies conference in, of all places, Grand Rapids, Michigan, in 2011. And all of a sudden, it came to me, let's do more of that, and the way I can do more of that is I start teaching a course. So then I had to get a job teaching. So I was working at the University of Connecticut at the time. I'm now retired. And I came back and put a proposal together and got approved, and I taught it twice a year for 5 years. And I'm always revising stuff. But it came out of that, and as well as having taught at UConn Book in history and then interdisciplinary studies, currently I'm involved with the Psychohistory Association and I help Brian out.
And he's present.
So a few years later at the same conference, I gave a paper trying to compare what different views of being human are by the famous biologist Edward O. Wilson from Alabama, and at Harvard, a famous literary critic named Terry Eagleton, and a not-so-famous psychologist named Richard Gross, who all wrote books about that. And as I was doing it, I thought, well, you know, each of them, even Wilson, covered certain areas and left out a great deal. And I thought, well, they're all being partial. And as I say in the paper, well, then it's sort of like I was going to critique them for that, but then I realized that's just pot critiquing the kettle, because I've been partial as well. So when I came back to my class, I said, let's figure out what everything we would need if you're going to address the question of what it is to be human, you have to know what it takes to answer. And so what it takes to answer it involves perspectives and research and outlooks from the natural sciences, the social sciences, humanities, and whatever. And the more I looked at things, hardly anybody had ever done it, and certainly nobody since academia became professionalized at the end of the latter part of the 19th century. So then I thought, well, how can I answer the question, address the question of what is the human, when I don't know what's involved? So then a good deal of what the paper is in this chapter is what's needed to be answered, how do we group topics, and then once that's occurred, how do I address everything? So that's the focus of this particular chapter, and if you read the stuff, then what I also do is say what the rest of the book is. It ultimately might be two volumes, if I get that far out with that one. So that's the framework for this. And as I said, I would say maybe Aristotle tried to be comprehensive in so many areas, Kant, Hegel, and more recently Edward O. Wilson, who's still alive, who wrote the book Social Biology in 1975, and is still writing, and he's in his 80s, and I once met him. I didn't ever meet Aristotle, Kant, but though I've gone to a number of seances to try to make contact with them, and instead I ended up with Pascal. And that's how I had to call him in the third time. Okay, so I'm going to try to answer some of these questions in the order that they were given, and I have 15 minutes. So, Paul's question is one that he asks me regularly, especially on Passover. So he says, you know, he asks, how is this specifically psychohistorical and brings psychoanalysis? So to me, this is intrinsically psychohistorical. It's my centerpiece of understanding how to be human is that we have become an evolving species. And that you can't understand what it is to be human unless you have the full scope of the history of Homo sapiens. Traditionally, history has been from what they call history as opposed to prehistory, was since we became literate, which is 5,000 years ago, and Homo sapiens are 200,000 years old. So I try to get the full scope of history. And then, integral to what's happened in the last 10,000 years, and even more importantly, the last 500 years, is how much our human's capacity for cultural, for creativity within culture, has transformed the whole history of what it is to be human. Between 1900 and 2000, life expectancy doubled. That's a big friggin' deal. And this has to do with our endowment of how creativity has evolved, basically, since we learned, even some have said before, but certainly since we developed agriculture 10,000 years ago in New Jersey. And so therefore, the creativity, the psychohistory of creativity is essential to this. Also, what I would say is psychohistory is that there is two elements in the human character that I think are important. And one is, that I talked about early on, there's a good part of us that's internally divided. So my favorite brief quote in the world is something that McCain says that I quote early on. We are, I know not how, double within ourselves, that we do not believe what we believe, and we cannot rid ourselves of what we condemn. And certainly a lot of psychoanalysis has similarities. And the other part is that we have this
mental capacity to focus, concentrate, collaborate together in a way that allows us, that works with our creativity and our imagination as well, that allows us to then make the kind of advances that we have and we still have. The psychoanalytic part isn't as much included as these other elements, but it is included in understanding our divisions, understanding where the unconscious plays its factor in things, understanding the role of projection in there, and also I have a chapter on the dynamics of family life, which will owe a lot to both marriage and family therapy, and also to psychoanalysis. Okay. So, Tom asked, do I think that basically the electronic revolution we're going through, one of his questions, is compromising? So, there's no simple answer to that, but part of it is how many of us function much without smartphones? How many without a dumb phone? But the smartphones, if I think about the electronic revolution and the technological revolutions going back to almost 100 years, or even a little longer, movies started in the 19th century. Automobiles started in the 19th century. 1919, the first commercial radio station. That changed people's lives. Television became a national focus at the end of the 1940s. Cable television in the 1980s. The computer revolution also started in the 1980s. These things have transformed lives. So I have an old, out-of-date smartphone. I have a home computer. And I want to find something out. I can't just. As a researcher, I need sources. I worked at the University of Connecticut. I live 55 miles from the University of Connecticut. I get on their library. I can find most anything I need. The focus, the change, the transformation of humanity in the last 500 years is connected to science, information, research, scholarship. We have long lived in a knowledge and information age, and this has done a number of things. But one of the things that it did from the Industrial Revolution is it diversified the number of specialties that are needed to keep civilization going. That diversification, this is a little separate from the electronic revolution, that diversification has then meant that we don't have to be working in factories. We don't have to be working 14 hours a day on a farm, that we have more opportunities to do things that might interest us, and there's more things available that might interest us because of the specialization. So on one hand, the whole technological revolution, including that we are now bombarded with everything on our smartphones, on our, becoming, for those of us who have cable television, with hundreds of channels that we have access to. People say that the texting revolution then has kept people apart because they spend more time on their phones and they do talking, and there's all the conversation always about kids at the dinner table not communicating with the rest of their family by phone texting. So there's that. So the second, since I had 7 minutes, has, are we crickets who are jumping end up in the mud? And my answer is we're both. And if you want, I can chirp like a cricket a little later. But or maybe even now. So that I say that we are, you know, as a divided species and with a complex character, that we've been able to both be constructive and destructive. And that they're often intertwined. But that certainly humanity has made tremendous strides in certain directions since the days that we were hunter-gatherers in Africa. We are now not only all over the planet, I can communicate with somebody, we've got somebody coming to the Sniper Street conference from South Africa. I can communicate with him like that. It used to be that people thought the Earth was the center of the universe. Now we've sent men to the moon and explored other planets. So in that sense, we have done more than anybody could ever imagine. 40 years ago, who would have thought that this would be something like this? So that's one answer. Okay. So Marcy, why am I doing this? It basically grew out of, you know, trying to understand myself. And then it sort of evolved into this extraordinary phenomenon. There's so many different aspects of being human, who we are, how we evolve, diversity, universality. So once I got started, it has taken a life of its own. That is the life. I'm investigating areas I never thought I would ever have any interest in whatsoever, but I need to do this. So it started just like, because I spent a lot of my life trying to understand myself, and people have told me it's not worth your while. Not that interesting. So then I moved on to these other areas. So it started with one thing, but it's evolved. Okay, Jacques, I didn't get right down what you said. Tell me, you had a question, Jacques. What was it that you said?
Yes, how do you actually play transcend? You as a lot of people. Cheers.
Right. What am I doing?
Yeah, how are you, this is all over, how do you think you'll transcend all Pascal, Montaigne, Shakespeare?
I can never equal any of those people. But what I'm doing that I don't think anybody else has really done since Hegel, is trying to do an interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary, comprehensive overview of what it is to be human. Edward O. Wilson in some ways has done that, but he's a reductionist. He believes in scientific reduction. So any other approach to things, but if that's in the natural sciences, social science, and the humanities, he doesn't give as much credence to it. Unless they fit into a scientific framework. And so I'm trying to do that by including old stuff with knowing that there's a lot of stuff that I'm just not as good as I think. Okay, Candace, is there an analogy between the developmental stages of an individual and society? So that's an idea that's been around for a while, that phylogeny mirrors ontogeny. And I guess that I would say that, you know, there's some ways that we are still infantile, and there's other ways that the way culture and civilization has developed since agriculture, as I said even more in the last time, that the development of humanity is beyond what anyone could have imagined. I don't know. Anyone could have imagined.
So I remember television. I remember seeing in the late 40s The Lone Ranger.
Right.
Look at all the changes since then. So I don't see that. I see that the development of human culture keeps changing and advancing in ways that are astounding. So, Ruth, I do see cycles in history as, in that there are some ways that, as Montaigne says, you know, that we have a character that has certain traits to it, and some of that doesn't develop, but other ways, history, some way doesn't repeat itself. Now, I should add that, say, what I wrote my dissertation on was on the cycle of American liberalism and radicalism, and I showed that each time it appears, it follows a similar pattern. But so there are ways that that does happen, but other ways it doesn't. So the story of humanity, without looking at how much we have changed since we were in Africa, you can't do it. You can't understand what it is to be human without understanding this extraordinary history and the creativity that has made this happen. It can only happen within evolving culture.
Okay. All right, so I want to take a shot at this question about when you mentioned Montaigne, in a way, I think you can sum up your whole approach to this topic by saying that humans have these contradictory sides to ourselves. And my concern, I don't know to what extent this meshes with what Paul was asking, but there seems to me to be something oddly ahistorical about talking about human nature in this way without looking at the span of history and asking ourselves how the constructive and the destructive impulses in humans have evolved. Now, to give an example of what I'm talking about, the best examples would be Hegel and Marx. Okay, who talk about history as being the overcoming of alienation, so that we end up in a better place than we started. And another example of this would be Steven Pinker, in the Better Angels of Our Nature. He says, yeah, we have these destructive and constructive sides to ourselves, but history has been the development of the state, the development of a political organization that contains violence and is creating the conditions for us to not be violent in the future. So I'm just wondering whether you can give a more historical twist to this idea of us having contradictory sides to ourselves.
And you know, okay. So my first response is, that's what I was doing. And that when I talk about being human, one side is the contradictions in our character. And there are other things as well that I mentioned, other people and other ideas, the dividing of us and them, the divisions between our social identity and our individual identity. And then I also talk about the role of creativity. So I don't just focus in on that. To me, you have to be able to show the human character that it incorporates a lot of stuff. And so once we get into, one of the things that we need to do in saying what is the human, looking at things historically, is why is it that certain conflicts come up for humanity, it may not come up for others. So, not only historically, but within the other species as well. So, recently, a group of Spanish investigators looked at 1,028 mammals to see how many of them have violence within their own species. And the answer is about 40%. And so we are among the 60%. But we also have violence and killing in ways that, say, differ from our closest relatives, the bonobos and the chimpanzees. So the bonobos hardly have any killing whatsoever, and the chimpanzees kill, but they kill in a certain pattern that's different than humans. They don't kill women, for instance. Adult and adolescent women, they don't do that. They kill primarily in groups for specific purposes, and we kill primarily in other groups. So in that regard, I also kind of placed human, when you address the issue of violence, human violence in certain ways. It's also the case that I agree with Pinker, and Pinker gets this from, I'm trying to think of the guy's name, Elias, which is, do you remember the name of the book?
Civilizing
Process. Well, he talks about the relevance of the state to limit intergroup killing, and I think that's correct. At the same time, as it's managing more within the state, and murder has gone down in a lot of places. But in the 20th century, according to a source that Steven Pinker likes a great deal, the death rate through war was greater than any of the previous three centuries. So that he's taking a shorter view of that. Also, this is a question that's come up between Brian and I a number of times, which is, what is human violence? And to me, human violence, human killing, is not just what goes on within our own species. We're going to talk about human violence and human killing. We have to recognize that most of the killing that is done by humanity has been done since there's anyone who could test this, is that as of non-human animals and plants. So in 1960, there were, like with the number of cattle, calf, chicken, lambs, turkeys, and pigs were killed, was about 1.8 billion in the United States. 50 years later, we were killing 450% greater than that. Almost 10 billion of those animals. So you want to talk about human violence, and you leave out that the center of human existence, the ability of us to be an industrialized species, is because of our skill and advanced technology in raising and killing animals. And so I say in the next chapter of my book that, as well as looking at what's characterized in humans as being our brains, our capacity for language, our sociality, our empathy, we have to include killing, because as of yet, being human and being a killing species cannot be the same. So that's my response to Brian, and Brian and I go back and forth on this, and probably will as long as we talk, and we'll have different outlooks.
This is such an incredible undertaking. So much erudition is shown in what you write.
I make things up.
That helps. But you make things up with a lot of referring to other authors, and this we've had a debate, I don't know, 4 or 5 years, Ken and I have been going back and forth over the civilizing process as one of the main foci, including symposium issues of Clio. And Ken has been, I tend to see the glass as half full, and he tends to see it as half empty. But striking today, you're more positive in your initial statement than you had been in prior discussions. It could be you just like to take the opposing view to mine. And I
knew I've been working on it.
Yes.
We won't say how he does it.
And I've been using this material, including his very lengthy discussions on killing, which is what would see the glasses half empty, with my students in a variety of courses. You bring up statistics in terms of the anti-Pinker, which you didn't make much about, but Pinker is the optimist, that we are getting incredibly, we're living longer, there's less violence in society than ever in the past. As bad as it is, and dangerous it is, it's, you know, it's not. I'm the optimist about these things. And Ken goes to statistics. I always say there are lies, damn lies, in statistics. And the biggest problem is not the lies and the damn lies, it's that when you start statisticating something, which we even barely did in our existence, it's very recent, you invariably find there's more stuff, because now you're counting it before you worked. Plus, there are specific groups who benefit by statisticating things, and that's part of the problem. So that would, that argument put forth to support things are better. But then you've been more positive now than before, so I probably shouldn't even brought that up again.
So you had said you had 4 things.
I worked them in. I worked the others in.
Okay. So as Brian and I have a certain kind of dialogue, and Paul and I have a certain kind of dialogue. So I want to say one thing and another. I have a darker side to me than Paul and what I think than Paul. But
well, you don't know deep down, but go ahead.
Well, I talked to Jerry.
My wife.
But I haven't agreed with your assessment that I see things more as half empty. And that you've seen a variety of versions of this chapter. And the part about our evolving as a species, it's always been a part. So on one hand, I don't see, as well as seeing the enormous changes that, for the positive, that say you and Brian both will say that I don't emphasize enough, I do see a continued dark side to us. And that one of the ways is that people talk about is we're now entering the sixth extinction. Clearly, let's just say we have a president who doesn't always seem to look on the bright side of things, and that's how he got elected. And also, one of the things that I'm concerned about is self-deception, and that people are not always able to look at the part of themselves that has negative influence on others, and more about how others are to blame than it's a mutual responsibility. And so that's how I see that as a part of everyday life. At the same time is, you know, my grandfather could not have had the kind of, unlikely to have the kind of my children were brought up in ways with possibilities that I didn't have, and that certainly my grandparents. So that's a step. That's, to me, is astounding stuff. And so, because I have this, what I consider a balanced view that you guys may think is not progressive enough, I think that I give credence to both sides. But that's not always how both of you see what I'm doing, and that keeps me back.
Tom?
I'm sorry. Okay. You're a historian. I can't believe you say these things about statistics. That's the short version of that. You need facts. Facts are better than fake news and a president who makes up his own facts.
I love facts.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Okay. Tom?
Yeah. I just quickly respond to your question. I think it's a very good question. The idea of come up with a transcendent image, right? Kind of picked up on that. Essentially, the project is way too big for the human mind. You're saying, let's how to figure everything out, everything, basically, right? And it reminds me of just the concept of positive transcendence, the film in 2001, where it's obviously a history film, right? First is the insight that the ape finally gets with the bone, right? The beginning of the film, where he becomes, now he really becomes a killing machine, but there's a creative evolution. Fast forward to 2001, where the humans are going out and finding something, monolith, and the end is a very peculiar, strange ending to the film, which is a star child. And so the star child is just a transcendent image beyond humans. And the basic comment that the star child makes is, this is wonderful, it's going to be wonderful. So that image that Kubrick and Arthur Clarke came up with is a positive, transcendent image when you think of everything, the evolution of things, right? So it's interesting you picked up on when he's really involved with research, heavy interdisciplinary research, and he's totally into it for whatever, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, then you're picking up like, wow, because you're seeing, holy Christ, what, we're amazing creatures, especially when you cover everything, like, it blows your mind, basically, so you have to come away with, like, wow, this is a good thing. Beyond, over and above the killing, which is our greatest trait, probably, you know, the death, the power we have, so it's amazing, you know. Yeah.
If you want me to talk, go ahead.
Yeah.
Mossy is next, though. Mossy?
Oh, okay. I was thinking about what Luke was saying about how history repeats itself. And you're talking about how we are evolving. And I was wondering if history repeats itself, to what extent are we truly evolving? And that led me to the question, what does it mean to evolve?
So the evolving is not only the astounding creativity and inventions and technology, the evolving is also how we're better at killing.
I'm sorry, I don't know.
How we're better at killing. We're better at being destructive. We have, so it's evolving in a variety, it's evolving in a variety of different ways. But so, you know, one of the things I talk about is, you know, in the very beginning, where I say we've gone from stone tools to smartphones, from superstition to science, from literature to Shakespeare, from bows and arrows to English. So the evolving isn't necessarily always what some people might consider. But the evolving also means that
as I've already said, we have more opportunities now to do more diverse things, to develop ourselves more than we might have, than species might have, when in the West most people were serfs, or in the earlier days of industrialization, when you work in a factory forever and you're going to get sick. So that sense that there's a distinct evolving in a way that gives greater opportunities for self-actualization. Okay, so she's going to do a follow-up.
But is that humans evolving or society evolving?
It doesn't happen. It's both, but it doesn't happen without society. It's society evolving. So that without culture, you wouldn't have science and technology. They're all collaborative enterprises. The same with business is a lot different. Government is a lot different. So one of the things I don't think I say, may say, yeah, I do say here. What would have happened to the talents of Einstein, Beethoven, and Hitler when the occupations available for hunting and gathering? So it's like what Sinatra sang about, what they used to say about love and marriage. You can't have one without the other. Without humans evolving, you don't have culture evolving. Without culture evolving, humans. So that's my response.
Lost a thread here for a minute. I wanted to get back in the good, bad thing.
Okay.
This sort of speaks to my question about developmental stages. And I think basically what you're saying about your work here, that it's a developmental achievement for the individual. And I think it's about, I hope, to be an individual, an achievement for civilization, to be able not to see things just in terms of good and bad. For instance, the glass isn't half empty. The glass isn't half full. It's both. We aren't good. We aren't bad. Electronics is both. But how are we going to handle that until, like the two-year-old, we are able to put the two together and begin to accept the potential that's available in both sides of the argument? I think that's what they're doing in the book, is also putting it together. It's reassembling the elephant for the blind man.
And trying to always, as much as possible, trying to look at the double-sidedness and the contradictions in things. And that things are not always either one thing or another, that they're often a combination of a multiple of things. And that's sort of where my perspective comes in, and maybe to some others might be the darker side, but that's how I see things, that there's paradoxes and contradictions as well as moving forward and all like that.
Okay, what I'd like to say is that a part of speaking is accepted. The role of this is where the speech now, to be relatively brief, so I'm here with everybody. Okay, so go on then.
But in that light of our dual-sidedness, which I'm very aware of, I wanted to, I was struck by Tom saying that the violence is an outstanding characteristic. To me, as a historian with a long view, I see our cooperativeness and our creativity as the outstanding characteristics, because we start 12,000 years ago, before women invented agriculture, with little foraging groups of 30, 50, 60 or all families, pretty much, killing other families because that's their sense of humanity. Now our sense of humanity is being extended by these wonderful horrible devices so that we care about people around the whole world. We hear a lot more about our neighbor and our loved ones, of course. But we've extended into the definition of humanity. So many more people, but I see a positive trajectory, even though, of course, I worry a great deal about that downside of our nature and the issue of regression, which is so powerful.
It's interesting, the whole idea of, I just talking about your question also, that the worldview and we're connected world, and you're saying, you know, well, yeah, we're more connected, we're more cooperative and more respectful and bonded with each other. But it also may be exactly the opposite. First of all, in terms of, let's just say neighborhoods, we're more connected to our neighbors. This is absolutely not true, right? What we do is go to work, drive home, go into the house, watch television. Neighbors now, I've been in one place for like 12, 13 years. I know two neighbors. And I'm not alone. Everyone knows, no kids playing the street anymore, so we're really isolated. And I was thinking about just what, just in terms of that context, and brought up by your question, 130 years ago, 120 years ago, Durkheim started talking about this. The nation state is going to be a problem. The mores that we've always had with villages, clan, now is disappearing. And now we're connected to another authority, right? That's what he said. And he said, and that gave birth to existentialism, right? The sadness, the anomie, the misery of like not really connecting. And now I think it's way beyond that. It's way worse now. Where, so yes, true, we know everyone and all that, but at the same, there's something else going on there that's really a disconnect from human beings. Really a serious disconnect from the, like this is a unique group in a way. Where this, we know each other 10, 15 years, and this is not that common anymore. You know what's his name, Putnam's book from Harvard. Forget about it, all went alone, right? This is disappearing, this kind of stuff. So it's an interesting.
I was about to call you, as a matter of fact. Go ahead, Marion.
Yeah, no, I'm just thinking about, I don't know to what extent this relates, but like when I was, you know, much younger, I used the typewriter. And I loved that, the feel of the typewriter clacking away. And even though it's not as sophisticated, you can't, you know, you have to use correct type or whatever. Like all these old things that I miss, like a TV set that had two channels, you know, volume, just on off and volume. Now I can never figure out anything with all these new gadgets. And I'm like, I don't know. And then just like getting together with people. I remember when, you know, I was young, there was kids we played on the street. And like I think children growing up today, they're really deprived. You know, when my kids were younger, we would sit around and watch TV together. And then as they grew up and went into, you know, college, and then they started sitting together with their laptops. And I, you know, now they're older, but I think the human, so I'm also thinking about nature and, you know, getting together with people, just having conversations. The younger generation, even talking on the phone is difficult. They have to chat. So talking on the phone is not as good as being, you know, face-to-face. So the art of just face-to-face, you know, communication, I don't think you can replace that. So with all the technology, which there's a good side, but the other thing that my mind is racing here, but I'm just thinking there's too much information. Like I look online to buy a product, and then there's 100 different varieties, and then there's 1,000 reviews on each one. I just get frustrated. You can't talk to somebody. You have a problem with Verizon or whatever. You have automated people. They sound like machines. And so I think that it feels like all of this makes us less humane. And I think people are thirsting for, they're thirsting for connection, but I think everyone's going about it the wrong way. The gadgets are becoming controlling people rather than, you know, I have patients who they say they can't put down their phone. They become addicted. And it's so hard for them to shut their phone off for an hour. So that it's like it's controlling us. So I think the humanity part is really like, how do we get children back to do the things that we used to do? You know, not be on computers all the time, but just play. Like, play is a lost art when you don't have, and children as program, so they don't have the time to imagine and just explore and not be fully booked. So I know I'm just like jumping from one tangent to the other, but I think some of our humanity gets lost in all this technology.
So, I like that. So, in the last few days, Tom and I have had a few email exchanges, in part because Tom writes a newspaper column and started off one of his columns with reference to this, so that's much appreciated about that. But he said other things that are similar to what you were saying. And in response, thinking about what you had said, I go back to Joan Benjamin. Both sides now. There's something lost and there's something gained. I'm living every day. And that may not always be the case, but there's an overall thing, I think, that there is that. There, you gain some things, you lose some things. And certainly, there's nothing like person to person connection. That's an essential part of who we will always be as long as our survival as infants is dependent upon a human being being there to feed us in whatever ways we get fed, and to be responsive to who we are, to the signals we put out when we're stressed or not. And that one anthropologist talks about that what distinguishes humans is that we have pair bodies. And that these things are one of the central enduring foundations of being human. So person to person can't be that. It also can be the most difficult thing in the whole world, but it can be. It's the foundation for us developing as beings and for what can enrich our lives.
Okay, I'd like to call someone on the spot and ask you a choice.
Well, I'm going to go in two totally different directions. One is Marion. You know, I'm listening to you, and there is another side. I'm actually very pessimistic. I mean, Ken and I were separated at birth. I think but I'm not that pessimistic about
That's
younger
why.
People. Even though, you know, I've read Sherry Turkle's books, I have four, they're actually step-grandchildren. They live in New Jersey. I never see them anymore, and they're off at school. But I stopped seeing them pretty much when they hit 12 because they were just off doing this and that and no time for me. And realizing they really had very, very full lives and saw their friends all the time. And there are two different families. And my buddy in my day job, who was at a Rockville Center, you know, he talks about his kids and what they're doing. And it's like, and they're very involved. And it starts with athletics, which is something I never had and never cared about. Sorry. But it's something. And so they're not on, I think when we see them on their devices all the time, some of it is that kind of, it's almost like when they used to stay in their rooms years ago, they didn't want to be around their parents. So I'm not as pessimistic. And the other thing is, so I live down by Gramercy, and if I tried to get into one of those restaurants or bars, I would be the oldest person there. There are so many young people congregating and being together. So I'm not so pessimistic. in that regard. But I'm kind of with Ken in a way about, I see humans as much more in terms of killers. The fact is, I think all the love and the libido and the eros is, we have to continue this species, but we also have to kill in order to continue the species, and we also have to kill in order to be sure that there aren't too many beings on the planet, and if we don't do it, nature will come up with new viruses. In a way, I'm very, very negative. And yet there is that creativity, but that creativity, I think, is about life and about continuing the species. I'm kind of addicted to, speaking of devices, there are cameras trained on a bunch of bald eagle's nests, and they're fascinating to watch. And some of the fascination is, even before the eggs are laid, watching the parents, you look at these nests, how do these animals know to weave? And how do they weave? And how do they know when to get up and rotate the eggs? I think we are programmed to give birth, to hatch, to whatever, but we're also programmed to kill. And both are integral parts of being human, and we can't do anything about that.
I'm skipping, please.
No, go ahead.
What disturbs me, hearing all this, what still disturbs me is the killing part. Because I hear, in my experiences of watching what's happening in the world, how that has not diminished at all. Through my eyes, it's become worse. And it's killing other humans. And how this has not changed over the years. And to me, that is what really, in addition to the positive things, but it's like, Freud's death instinct, and, Thanatos and all that, is so present. And when you see what's happening in Syria and how innocent people are killed, this is not to save species or to have more room. It's hate and discrimination and religion and political and whatever other categories you want to say. But that is the negative part that I perhaps more associated with this, the humanity that I'm living with nowadays.
I'm all set.
Okay, then, Brian, go ahead.
All right, so I want to come back to Marcy's question before. If history repeats itself, it will really evolve. And I don't think it's an adequate answer. Your answer was, well, our capacity for violence has also evolved. I don't think that this is an adequate answer. I think that one way of answering this is Croce's idea of the spiral. And yes, it repeats itself, but always on a higher level. And I guess what I'm missing from your paper is the higher level. When you say, when you compare humans to other species, that seems to me to be, an ahistorical, it creates necessarily an ahistorical way of thinking that, they kill for such and such purposes, we kill for such and such other purposes. Implicit in this is some kind of a, human nature that doesn't change, or the idea that somehow we have to kill to eat, and therefore that's just an inherent and unchangeable part of the human condition, and therefore killing will always be with us in one form or another. All of this strikes me as ahistorical. So to wrap up and put on a fine point what I'm trying to say, if you were to look at moral evolution, if you were to concede that there has been moral evolution, that that we abolished human sacrifice, isolated instances of it still occur, but as a normative matter, it's no longer acceptable to kill people. for human sacrifice is no longer morally acceptable. Okay. Similarly, we abolish slavery. Right. And if you could say, okay, so now what's next on the agenda? What's next to abolish? War. What's next on the agenda? Maybe animal rights. Maybe we need to stop killing animals for food. Okay. So then you're in a realm where we can see where we're going or where we should be going. But if we just have these opposite forces within us, and that's just the way we are, and that's your ultimate summation of human existence, that doesn't go anywhere.
So I don't really want to go anywhere. So I'm going to stay here. So I would, and this is something I would say, that I don't say that having a divided consciousness, as Monty says, is the only way to look at the world. And I don't think that discussing bringing in that we're related species and how we compare to other mammals and other primates, I don't see that as being ahistorical at all, necessarily being ahistorical. I think that it actually does, that doing that does some of the same thing that history does. It's a comparative element, and that the examples you're giving are also comparative elements. We have some of the characteristics, and what I said is, look, we have some of the characteristics of mammals and primates and our close related primates, but we have other characteristics. And that's a way then of looking, because we're not just, we are biological creatures as well as other kinds of creatures. And so, therefore, to me, let's just say, to see that that humans kill intimate partners and chimpanzees don't, and there could be a variety of reasons for that.
Will that always be the case? Because you're making it as an eternal statement.
No, I'm not making it as an eternal statement.
No, you just said humans kill. You made a statement.
That's a present
statement. Atemporal generalization.
That's a present statement. It's
right.
Not that. It's a statement.
Okay.
Humans kill.
Have always killed.
I didn't say that. I don't know that. But they do kill intimate partners, and chimpanzees don't. What that does is, that helps understand that there are certain traits that have gone on for a long period of time in humans that are different than what goes on for other species that we share 98% of our DNA. Certainly, there is what you say is which I wouldn't use the term moral progress, but certainly it's beneficial that we don't do human sacrifice and lose slavery, and that women have opportunities that they didn't have for much of the course of human history. No question about that. But that. For you to say to me that I'm being ahistorical when much of what I'm writing about is how we have evolved and how we continue to evolve, and that's dramatic. But where I think, since we have talked before, you may I see more mixed parts of being human and have less expectation that some of the destructive sides of being human can disappear than you do. But that doesn't mean that I'm ahistorical.
Okay.
In my view, I mean, that doesn't have to be you.
That's a good question. When you're speaking now, please try to be rough and deep, so okay, Joyce, you had your...
It makes sense to me that history will keep repeating itself, Bruce, if I take it on a very micro level and see what goes on in my office. and or even in my own life. You know, and no matter, you know, after 30 years of analysis, somebody can know so much and have changed a lot about their behavior, and yet there are imprints that cannot be changed. And, you know, I've seen patients just make incredible progress, and then a patient I worked with for years, and then she left me very suddenly and almost literally went off to repeat her mother's life. And I think that, you know, there are imprints in each of us and also in society, and we cannot break free of them. And so I think history does repeat itself. So, you know, so when you talk about the slavery, you know, we don't have slaves anymore, but the desire to denigrate and subjugate people who are not like me, or who are not white, who are not, you know, Jewish, who are not, you know, whatever, is still very strong. And we saw candidate Trump enabling people to let go of some of their socialization, let their ids come up, and it became okay for a lot of people to embrace publicly the things that we aren't supposed to be doing or feeling. Because you can't, I don't believe you can wipe out some of the basest parts of human nature, but also, I mean, just the instinct to love and care for your children, which is not universal, because yes, mothers, there are mothers who kill their children, fathers who kill their children, but you know, I think you're going to keep seeing this. I mean, are you ever going to see a country start a, you know, an industry based on killing people like in Germany? I don't know, but certainly ISIS was doing everything it could without building the factories. There is, you know, a need to dominate, to denigrate, and then the flip side, to love, give birth, and educate, and create.
Yeah, and so I want to go say something you're talking about. There are, so there's an anthropologist named Ronald Fox. He teaches at a place called Rose School at night. And he said back in 50 years ago, there's no culture, there's no human culture that doesn't have kinship. Kinship connections that isn't organized by kinship. And this goes to something that had, even though he was the diversity that has evolved, that hasn't, that, or put it this way, the way we raise our children has evolved, but that has happened within families is a human universal. In that human universal is the attachment process. If that doesn't occur, kids aren't going to survive. Period. That part of things isn't going to change. Who does the nurturing is something else. But another thing that seems to be universal is that there are a number of cultures that don't practice raising infants the way we do. There are some of them where you have 14 people who nurture an infant. There's an anthropologist who talks about that we're collaborative leaders, and that's what makes us distinctive. I mean, Sarah Blaffer-Hardy, she's worried because we don't do that stuff.
Sarah who?
Blaffer-Hardy. She's written a number of books. The one that I'm referring to is Mothers and Others, She or. But one of the things that I look at biology, psychology, history, I also looking at the total of being human, want to look at anthropology. And so there's a lot of research on attachment. So even when there are multiple caregivers, within 10 months to a year, a baby prefers one caregiver over another. usually goes into the biological type. That's just a part of, there are other things also you can say are part of developmental sequences. So at the age of one, I'm going to have much less mental capacity than I'm going to have at the age of 12, 15. So as well as being historical, it's also important to recognize that there are certain, there's a life cycle, there are developmental stages, and though these can be modified, you still build on them. It's essential part of understanding being human as that we become involved in species.
Okay. Tom and then Marcy.
Yeah, very complex conversation, really. You know, everyone is also, one, certainly one thing that strikes me, the idea of repetition versus evolving. It's interesting. And so you were saying things get imprinted in the human, which really means repressed in some way. You're talking about that. Then you said that things get imprinted by society. Is that true? Is a repressive mechanism actually playing out in society? Probably not. Maybe that's why you're kind of so, you're happy about, you can see cultural evolution, but then there's another story here underneath, which is, well, what about human change or no change? I mean, what do we do? You know, I see patients 10, 20, 30 years, two times a week, three times a week. I know how. Just like you said, Wallenstein's book is, the biggest story about that book is when they studied 40 people, real psychoanalysis for 20 years each, the conclusion was, guess what, they still had secrets. Unbelievable secrets still, right? Mm-hmm. So this idea of repression is a very big thing, but it's probably human and it's not societal. So you have this evolution of a society, but you don't necessarily have the evolution of an individual. There's repressive mechanisms that are so powerful. I mean, we deal with it every day, that question. And everything goes against looking in, right? Mm-hmm. Every conversation is, how's the weather today? You know, that kind of thing. So that's one thing that strikes me. It's like, wow, you know, this is a...
Ken?
So someone else.
Thank you very much. But Marcy, and then Paul.
Sorry, just, you know, who knows? I wonder, you know, to what extent evolution is superficial. But also, what's come up a couple of times is this slavery, that we don't have slavery anymore. I would actually beg to differ that we still have slavery, but it must manifest itself in different ways. We have sex trafficking, which is obviously slavery that we have. But also, I believe in some ways we are, many of us are slaves to some kind of system, whether it's you have to have a job, you have to stay in your job because you have the health insurance that you rely on. So I would just say I would, you know, beg to differ on that in terms of the slavery question.
Well,
there's slavery, yeah. And we have to wonder why that is. What is it about being human that perpetuates?
Well,
situation.
I would just say, as I say in the part here, man is not falling from heaven. So there are a lot of things we have to do because we need to eat, children, you know what I mean? There's a lot of things that we have to do because part of this human condition. Some of us don't have to earn our daily bread, and others do.
At some point, when we finish the discussions, if it's okay, if you sort of turn to your actual, you know, the structure.
Oh, okay.
The things I do have to comment on that structure.
Okay.
I'm Paul.
It's such rich conversation that I don't want to go in so many directions. One is I'm 100% in support of Ken's use of data from before the Bruegel area of what we supposedly became civilized 5,000 years ago. And in fact, what our animal ancestors tell us a lot about ourselves, and tracing us from different time frames is extraordinarily important. And Ken does a wonderful job of doing this. And it will need to be corrected as we get more knowledge. Mm-hmm. And we've become, it took Darwin had great trouble just accepting that we simply weren't in God's image, but we were related to, rather God was in our image, that we were related to different, to mammals and different species. We feel enslaved, we have got lots of data, accounts of slaves in the 18th century when they started to actually think maybe slavery isn't such a good idea. And Marcy, it's a heck of a difference between feeling enslaved and being enslaved by your own volition and someone else control of your body and labor. I wanted to speak against the pessimism that it's so easy to have in our society, that Ruth and Joyce brought up a bit. If you had a historical perspective, long-range historical perspective, I don't think it would be as quick to say this. We have well over 7 billion people in the world, despite the killing, and the killing is so much less proportional. It's horrible, 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 but it's so much less proportionally than in the past. That's important to keep in mind. Just the pessimism about humans, oh, we got too many humans, we'll have to restrict it. Humans, my friend Joyce's comment, is before Earth Day, I organized a week-long at Temple University for the biologists, Earth Week, and I was a fierce environmentalist, but the one thing I never bought was humans are simply polluters. We're hearts and minds and creators rather than polluters. And I never bought into the Malthusian notion more humans, more pollution. We can live together in incredible numbers. And we know how to do that when we're ready to do it, as we have been to a great extent. Yeah, one of the things that we have very little that is imprinted on us. Oh yes, when we're in utero, there's some imprinting from the mother. We know that. When we're pre-verbal, it's very important imprinting. But those eagles have it imprinted so that they will do these things, and they don't have, their learning cycle is much less. Nature is what's overwhelmingly important to them. For us, it's nurture, that we are so changeable, one of the values of these many cultures. So I tend to be very optimistic. I'm delighted. I've got 7 grandkids, 3 kids, 7 grandkids. If my daughter's body hadn't gotten tired, I'd have more than the 5 that she, as the heroine of my family, produced. I can't walk by babies in the supermarket or any other place without being just focusing on them, because new life is wonderful. I don't know what they'll turn out to be. They could be potential Donald Trumps or Hitlers. Not my favorite people in the world, even though I teach on Hitler and Holocaust and genocide, and teach on Trump. But I look for the positive And if you take the historical view, if you see that glass as half empty, you'll find so much as negative. The evidence is overwhelmingly, in my view, to the positive. Enough of my lecture. Sorry.
He's a speaker. He can smart.
I'm okay for the moment.
Okay. Tom? I thought you had your hand.
I wouldn't mind hearing what Marcy wants to say about it. I don't have Darwin. I finally finished reading The Origins of Species in the last six months. But I don't have Darwin in here, and I'm certainly in dialogue with the neo-Darwinians that have a little different stuff. No Darwin. So, okay.
So this is the introduction to the first volume.
It's an introduction to both volumes, but it's sort of saying, yeah, that's okay, right.
Okay. Well, when I read this, it was almost overwhelming. The task that you have, you know, it's like mammoth, you know, undertaking. You know, I can't, you know, underestimate that. This is going to be such an amazing achievement, you know, as you're, you know, working through it. And I thought, you know, I noticed, you know, there's so much in here, you know, it's packed a lot into a small space, it feels like. I thought what had been pursued, and this is sort of a couple of suggestions, you had that quote by Pascal up front.
Right.
You know, you said, oh, what a Chanel is man, what a monster, Blaise Pascal writes, what a chaos, what a contradiction, what a prodigy.
Right.
Which I think speaks to the sort of the negative and positive and this, you know, double sort of sidedness. And I thought, wouldn't that be great as a people to describe? You had one of those kinds of statements. So that's why I asked you, why is it that you want to examine, you know, what it means to be human? Because I saw in here these quotes.
Right.
That you were using that were attempting to answer that question themselves. So,
and they've illuminated me.
And they've illuminated you. But also there was that statement, and that's not in terms of the structure, how you want to organize what questions you want to ask and when you answer them.
Okay.
Because on page 1 through on page 5, there's the question, what it means to be human. There is not agreement about how to ask the question alone, let alone on the answer. So I was wondering if you could, if it's as a suggestion, to address that type of question first before you jump right into this is what it means to be human. Because I still feel you're kind of attempting to articulate what that question is. But just before I go on. I also asked you why you wanted to examine this, because I thought, and you told me that it stemmed from your need to understand yourself, right?
And to understand, exactly, make sure he's in there.
So I do have a suggestion, which is perhaps you could start your introduction with an anecdote.
Okay.
So start with, this is where it started.
Okay. Can you give me, okay. So other people have said something like this to a variety of my writings, which is, okay, start with something. So a little later I do the anecdote about how I got to New to Comprehensive, but I could start with how and why this became an issue to me, and that would draw people in more than just saying, well, what is it to be human, and then you'll build a little bit and you go to Pascal.
Well, then address the complexity of asking the question itself,
okay.
And then moving on, because I thought there was some great stuff in here, but I kind of thought that I got a little bit lost at times, and maybe some explication, a bit more explication needs at times, so you wanted to cover so much material.
So, since you've obviously marked that up,
yeah,
if you want to, okay, all right, that'd be easier than having you send something to me. Okay, that'd be great. That's the kind of, you know, among other things, that's the kind of thing I need. I said to Paul the other day, I cut 3 pages out of what you guys had, because I think that a lot of times I have a tendency to put too much in and lose my sense of direction. So that's always a concern of mine. And so then how to make it clearer for somebody else is always.
Address your head, please, don't fall out. Okay. Well, Tom, and then Paul and you. And,
I think she's right. It's utterly overwhelming. So what does one do about it, right? Short of eventually the interdisciplinary data will be dealt with by a computer and that'll pop something out, right? It's what it means to be human. But what I thought as I was reading, and I think that's why I wrote it in my column, that this is a project that many, many great writers have undertaken for over the last 1,000 years, right? And so I think maybe you could pick top, maybe 10, whatever masterpieces, and it takes a long time to read them, but each has a different message about what it's like to be human. Proust, basically, you read him, it's to be human is to appreciate beauty. Cervantes, to appreciate courage. Melville, kind of to appreciate maybe fame and courage. Shelley was pretty interesting also, right? To appreciate, when you're creative, you got to deal with your creation. So there's maybe 10 major writers with major masterpieces, and when you read them, there is basically one element that they're talking about, whatever that is for them, and it's different. Climbing the mountain, or sense of morality, Dante, right? So that always the image of a mountain, usually, and a tunnel going down, but also, morality is a big part of it as well, so that may be a hook as well, like a whole, like, well, this is the human project from this genius's point of view, that, and that may help also. That's what I was thinking, as I read this, because otherwise it's like, wow, it's too daunting, really. It's too much data without that, like you said, the transcendent image,
I was just saying you were very lively, but now you're going to go.
I was thinking, to get the reader really into it is to get them to, burn with the curiosity that drove you to embark on this monumental task. So you're thinking, why is this so necessary? So to draw the reader in, how you got there.
Tom was saying, I love that idea of engaging in a conversation, right, with the different fundamental approaches or lenses, because what the common thread is, right, is that they are asking that question, essentially, what does it mean to be human? And when you do so, don't forget Freud, because I felt that Freud, because I felt he was actually asking that question himself.
I do. That's why. That's one of the things. That's one of the things that drew me to Freud, because I thought he was.
I think we did a lot of good job.
Pardon?
Yeah.
Okay.
These cyclists reforms are at their best when they push the boundaries of the presenter and of course make it interesting for the group. And Marcy, I think, and Tom, that's such a wonderful idea to get Ken to focus on have himself to the narrative. In writing my book, you're going to discover, those of you who read it, you're going to discover that it's a memoir of Paul Elovitz, and is approximately 50 years in psychohistory, and hopefully that will be engaging the reader, along with both a lot of names and origins and controversies and struggles over issues. I have been pushing, I lured Ken to the psychohistory forum because of his...
And we won't say what he did to Lord.
It's now against the law. because of his interest in Freud and the Oedipal complex. I think there's a tendency that he had to be too respectful of different people, that you go to different fields, and so many fields of this incredible erudition. But you have to bring it back to yourself and that which you know best. Oh yes, you throw in Darwin, who I love.
I don't throw
along with Freud.
I don't throw it.
I said you should throw it. My suggestion is not only to follow through on what others have done, that you're in there, but to say, can we have a dialogue for Cleo Psyche in which we go through the way you elaborated because of my constantly bringing up that issue of how is this psychoanalytic, how is it psychohistorical? And you elaborated almost a half dozen different ways it is. Can we go through those issues, that listing that you did at the beginning, and elaborate on them? Because I think that would help make it a richer book and a more human book. That's my thought.
All right. I will respond.
Okay. You respond in the
surprise. So, probably a major experience in my life was spending 357 days behind a typewriter in a war zone. So, in the next chapter, which is basically on killing, one of the things that, so it was, and I had, you know, before they had a name for it, I certainly had post-traumatic stress disorder afterwards for a long period of time. And that was also one of the things that troubled me, is that you typed, you weren't in any jungle. The most adventurous thing you did is climbing a mountain so you could see Bob Hope. And yet, I mean, there were rocket attacks, and there was a guy in my unit who got shot, and there was a guy who wanted to shoot me who I'd never seen before. But it's sort of like, well, why did I get PTSD when I wasn't in certain circumstances? Now, recently they've come up with the notion is that if you're exposed to certain kinds of violent incidences, which rocket attacks would be, that it affects your system in a way that can lead to what? But that's just for every reason. So this is one of the, so this, and being troubled for a number of years because of that, is one of the things that drove me to this. And then what goes on with this is that in the process of doing reading about war, from Paleolithic time to World War II, there are instances of mutilation that I won't describe because it's very hard to take, but I will describe it. They don't happen very often. Actually, one of the instances happened in this very island in the early days of the Dutch or English settlement, I think it was. They are just the most horrific things that one human being can do to another. And it doesn't occur that often, but it is a phenomena that recurs. And the question was, how can one human do this to another? And this is much of these kinds of things, both my own personal experience, the trauma that I had, and some of these things discovered, that are some of the impetus for certain aspects of the book and for my preoccupation with making sure that the destructive side of us is important. So I don't know if that's the kind of story as an anecdote, because it's certainly what
the arc of the whole book. What drove me
and so that one of the more challenging things for me is trying to put myself in the position how it is that someone could do those kind of mutilations to others, and it occurs, there's enough occurrence of it from the hunter-gatherer period to ancient Egypt to World War II, you know, and that is, you know, so it's the experience of war and then trying to come to terms with it and then reading stuff about it that then led me to have to look at this, and then, as I said, how can I imagine that I would do this myself? And the answer was some of Paul's criticisms of my work. No. And so it's sort of like, here to me is one of the worst things that's ever happened, that it happened more than once. How could anybody do it? How could I have done that? That would be an honest way of saying what initially drove me and then what has continued to drive me, but that doesn't explain the comprehensive part of things that I also think is important. But that might be, that's a beginning that certainly would be honest. And also could bring people in, you know, there's a Thomas Hardy, the poet, says, you know, to understand what's better, you have to understand the worst. And I think I say something like that here, and I say the opposite is also true, right? Understand the worst, you have to understand the better, and what's in it. But this is, I think. So that could be, I mean, that's one possibility. That would be an honest way of what makes a difference to me.
Okay.
So, another way, I want to come back to what Tom said about, you know, the dialogue with the great thinkers and sort of take a different, slightly different angle on this. I think there's merit in what you're trying to do in the sense of an exhaustive academic survey of this topic. Okay, I think there's merit in that. But at the same time, what Tom is suggesting is sort of a different way of going about writing a book like this. And I don't necessarily, I think you'd have to like completely rewrite it or completely change your writing style to go the full distance with what he's saying. But what I want to underscore in what he's saying is that no matter how exhausted you are going to be in this project, you're still going to only be scratching the surface of the relevant literature. I mean, for one thing, you're probably mostly limited to what's done in English and maybe one or two European languages, right? So, I mean, there's a lot of stuff out there that's going, and more, even more than that, the scientific revolution is just the knowledge explosion is just sort of getting way ahead of us, right? So I guess my conclusion from hearing what Tom said is to trust your own voice, to trust your own ability to be more selective and to recognize that some things are more important than other things. And that there's like, you're going to always have a ton of facts in this thing and a ton of information and evidence and all of that stuff. But at the end of the day, the coherence of it, there's got to be more coherence in your mind than what comes through in this paper. And you should trust your own voice to assemble this stuff in a way that is more digestible.
Could you say more about what you mean by more coherent than what's in the paper?
Well,
where to you is it coherent?
The paper, it's not that it's not coherent. It's that it's one damn thing after another. It's like a list of information. It reads more like a list of information. And so you, if you model yourself more on Hegel, you know, it's like not everything is equally important. I mean, like, you know, and so what are the big organizing ideas here? And trust that every person who writes a book like this is going to write it differently, right? So you're going to write a unique book that's going to be shaped by your own thinking, and it's okay for it to be like that. You can't necessarily get to that place on Mount Olympus where you'd like to be, where this thing is going to be, you know, equally doing justice to everything, you know.
Yep. We're talking a little bit, certainly last half hour or so, about the motivation, you know, what's the personal motivation. One thought I have is, when I was reading it also, is that it's almost like you've been infiltrated by the spirits of Monday, the zeitgeist, the deep collective unconscious that's happening now. Well, what's happening now? Scientific revolution is unbelievable, right? So what does that mean? That means that humanity, you talked about it a little bit, I certainly talked about it, humanity is in some way going to be altered and changed. Probably that's why Trump won. The wall, let's hold on to ourselves, right? So the idea of the Spiritus Mundi, of the movement of science and technology and computers, and knowledge of the computer, right, means what that humanity is going to shift, and there's kind of a crisis, and that made enough on a deep level. That's what I was thinking. That's one reason it's happening. That we better start writing about humanity. This is a good idea, really good idea. So.
This idea of making it more personal, I think, is very important, because I find myself when I read a scientific paper that when the author is into it and talk about their own experience, it makes so much more sense and much more alive, as you were some of you were saying about all the beautiful and very hardworking list of people that should be included, but how it affected you, going back to perhaps your beginning question of, you know, why did we do this? But also, I go back to the issue of this chapter that you're going to write about why do we kill? And, you know, besides whatever the philosophy is, it's happening now, it's happening all the time, it never stopped happening in all the countries in the world, in South America in the 70s, and, you know, that the humanity that we have or we don't have, I mean, the two sides of it, probably the technology and how we can be better, but it's the other part of it, that we employed and all the things that are important to include, but also to you, because you are not there.
No, I agree, just to make it really interesting for the reader, and as your personal experiences will capture more, draw the person in and want to hear more about it. I think that's, yeah.
Mossy?
So two things. So first of all, I think maybe we'll go on with also getting at not so much the coherency, but the cohesiveness of the piece. There's a difference, isn't there, you know, between having coherent message and a logical flow and the cohesiveness between these elements that you're bringing together. So that was, you know, sometimes I think that's where my observation that there was just so much information packed into such a small amount of space to cover all these different things from, for example, we have diverse approaches to being human in a page. And, you know, towards an interdisciplinary vision in a page. Dialectic humanism in a page, so long. But also, another question you were saying about why is it that we are driven to kill? Why do we do that? On the opposite side of the spectrum, of course, why are we driven to reproduce? So it is this dialectic thing that I think you're striving to pursue.
So one of the things that has been that reshaped what I did in the introduction, as I said earlier, is that they asked the question, what does it mean to be human? But to the modern, from the 19th century to the present, with the possible exception of Robert Wilson, no one has tried to consider what do you have to do to be able to address that question. The people start from a place that they're comfortable with, and then they may expand a little, but they leave out so much. And it's that partiality and omission that to me then means, well, if you're asking the question what it means to be human, and you're leaving out this, and you're leaving out that, and you're leaving out that, you can't answer the question. And so that meant that I'm going to try to the best of my ability. Let me say, here's what all you need to do to answer this question. Otherwise, you're asking this question, you're staying within your own parameters and your expanders. And you can't fully address the question. So that then, once I got to that point, that means that it ends up like this. And so, and I know that say the response that I get is, holy shit, you're doing so much, all that, but it's not always drawing people in. And so like, I don't know a way, but I don't, you know, within my own stuff, I don't necessarily know a way around that, where I think that when I go to the next chapter, it starts off with, you know, humans do not live by bread alone, fowl, fish, and beaver staples of our appetite, and then go into killing. There's stuff that I'm going to say there that's going to draw people in. And the chapter after that is on attachment, and the stuff that I'm going to say there that's going to hit them, that's going to touch people. But in this one, outside of the beginning, I don't know how to then or where to put that we need a comprehensive overview and let's see how to do it. I don't know how to get around that part of things.
Okay, in order of hand raised, Marcy, and then Tom, and then Paul, and then Jeff. Marcy, go.
Okay, so that's why when I asked the question, why did you want to do this? Because I think you have it all here, which is that some of your sections can be moved around.
Okay.
And you answer the question here, you know, by verbally articulating what it is you seek to do.
Right.
And I'm listening to you and thinking that none of really what you've just said today is in here.
Okay.
You jump right in. What does it mean to human? But you haven't laid the foundation.
Okay.
And what you have done today by talking to us is exactly that. So when you spoke today, this is why I'm doing it, this is what it means, I think, wow, that makes so much more sense to me now that you have said it, because it's in here, but it's embedded in all this, in all this information.
So, that's pretty good. I should just add that all my life, more or less, I've been a better talker than writer. But these are the kinds of things that's helpful to know, because so that the reader gets what I'm doing. So what I started with, of course, is obviously, you know, we've gone from stone tools to smartphones, yada, 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 the various quotes that I like, and then say, well, but this is my view, but it's not everybody's. And that, so I don't know if that first section, which I liked a lot, because I think I sum up a good deal in the first couple of pages.
but more emphasis on the part where I say, here's how I got to, everybody's being partial. Make that more folks front and center than it is.
Just unpack it a little bit.
Okay.
Tom and then Paul.
Yeah, just two things. One, in terms of the trauma and experiencing the trauma, I was thinking many, many writers, you know, the great writers, initially they had two things happening kind of simultaneously. One, many of them had some kind of serious trauma, war, go to jail, serious illness that's really dangerous during childhood. Right. That's one thing you notice. The other thing you notice is that anyone who produces really the great masterpieces, they took about 20 years. They tended to be from very wealthy families, so they had time and they had money. They had a lot of time. Like Krauss, he didn't. These people were not working. They were supported by wealthy aristocracy, you know. And so you have that's another phenomenon. This is not a 1 year project. It's a 20 year project. You have. And you need support, and you need time, and that's the way it is.
So we're the rages before him, so we're taking up the donation.
Okay, Paul.
I want to do two things here. One, start with Ken's role in my writing, the making of psychohistory, because for at least 25 years, I've been talking, you know, someone needs to write the book on the history of this field, and talking that maybe I should do this, and being distracted, being uncomfortable with going all the way in writing it. And Ken heard this as a friend, and he said, well, why not, don't we give a presentation on that? But why not this article, why don't you write about some of this or article in the journal or, you know, or another journal, whatever. He kept encouraging me and getting me to help focus on it. That was quite valuable. And he also, as well as he is one of some people who did terrific editing to make it better. The type of focus that different people are coming forward, Marcy, who teaches some of this stuff, is helping direct. And that's an important gift and very much appreciated. Now to Ken, doing this almost impossible two-volume task, I'll probably come up with four volumes, because that's a way of not only extending his intellectual range, but of postponing it. Something he's always very nicely keeping me not to do. And by the way, I may have written in my mind, but I wrote it in the summer. And I'm a famous procrastinator about writing. I wrote it in the summer, and then it's getting better and better with the help of colleagues like Ken. And I have a very long acknowledgement. We hear Ken talking about this, being a better talker than writer. And what does he do? He engages us, and if there's the slightest sign that he's going to lose us, he brings in humor. Engages us with his humor. And there's a little bit of pushing away with the humor, too, from the subject being maybe too intense or with too different in view. But he's wonderful and engaging, and yet, for years are going on, and you know, saying, Ken, you're going from authority to authority to authority, you're giving me lists and so forth. That's not what's going to pull people in. That's not what's going to make people want to read it. And the version that I got a few days ago, the three pages out, the better version, but boy, what people have been suggesting here will make something that will be so much more meaningful. Beginning of the on killing, you can start with that quote, but the next thing you move into is what happened. You're shaking your head. No, I think.
What part? I'm not sure what I'm thinking.
I'm just being unclear.
Okay.
The next thing you move into...
Well, where's the quote on killing?
Oh, that you had, man, he lives not by...
Oh, that's not a quote. Oh, that's a quote from me.
Yeah.
Okay, that's my own, that's that's not a quote from somebody else, that's a quote from me.
Yeah, oh, you love that quote. And it's very, mm-hmm. to the point, but then say, or maybe first say, I was around killing. I didn't kill anyone, nobody killed me. But say what he told us, and pull the reader there, and then go through the different elements in the killing chapters that you've written about, we've gone through, and you've improved. And you will have a much more engaged audience.
Right. Yeah, so I think that, as I said, there's a problem. The subject matter that I come to isn't going to be as interesting, but seems to me to be necessary and has to be the case.
Make it
How do you make interesting that you have to have a deal with doing condition? I mean, well, I have to have a comprehensive view. But I do think that there's ways I can do the beginning that brings people into why I'm doing this. What I don't know as of yet is what I can do to bring people more into that. I'm trying to develop a comprehensive overview of what it means to be, what needs to be done to have a comprehensive overview. And I don't know how the hell to do that so that it can draw people in the same way that they think each one of the chapters will.
Yeah, I want to take a shot at that very thing you just said. Okay. So I think that you can only go so far in terms of bringing in personal anecdotes and stuff like that. I mean, yeah, some of that might help. But this book is not going to be for everyone. This is going to be an academic book. The question is, who... But the question is, so if Hegel were writing this book today, what would it look like? And or any of these thinkers that you said, Aristotle, Kant, Hegel, Edmund O. Wilson, okay? So I'm gonna suggest that model yourself more on these thinkers and not on a person who's trying to provide an exhaustive summary of the literature. And the difference is this, that if you read any of these thinkers, the sentences flow in a kind of logical way. It's like one thing leads to the other. It's like you're telling a story. If you read any of these thinkers, Aristotle, they're telling a story, and it's not a story.
You're the first person I've ever say that about Kant.
Well, but what I mean by that is one thing leads to another.
It has to have a narrative. One thing leads to another,
and there's a logical sequence to the ideas.
Okay.
That I don't see in this.
Okay.
And I think that if you were, and where does that sequence come from? It comes from you.
Okay, so that.
In other words, it's how you organize the stuff. But start with the big idea, which is that we're dual within ourselves. That's your big idea. Okay? And then everything else should unfold from that in a way that you're telling this story, and it's going to contain everything that's already in the paper, but it's going to be organized in a way that's a lot more digestible to people.
So then. Since some of the people here I don't talk to that much, and others I do, and you're one of the ones that I do, then you had said sometime we can sit down and talk about this, or just be you and me, we can talk about how this doesn't seem to be sequential here, and have a narrative flow. That would be helpful.
Okay.
Sure. Okay, Nancy, go ahead.
All right, so I'm going to do this.
Right.
I've built you a new outline.
Okay. So
maybe she's done.
She's multitasking.
Right. So as a suggestion, because you're saying I know what I need to do, but I don't know how
to make work,
how
work.
To do
make
it. Work. So that the answer to that question is how you structure
right.
your piece. So as a suggestion, even work around this, there's a place to start. You know, you start the anecdote, but you have to. Your first question has to be. Think about who your audience is, right? But also what your purpose is. So your purpose is to provide a comprehensive overview. Why? why do you feel that you need to provide a comprehensive overview? Because you feel that other people have only provided partial approaches. So then you would go into the different approaches that have come through, right? So you start there. And then that would lead to your moving towards bringing them together and reinforcing that central thread, which is asking that question, what does it mean to be human? As a starting point. Yeah.
Yeah, I'd kind of like to turn that around, a half empty instead of a half full. Instead of saying, what is the commonality here? Which probably no common, but what is it? Why do people always leave on something? Is there a meaning in that? Is part of the problem that we can't handle our being human? We have difficulty with it. Is there things we insist on leaving out? That there are things we don't want to deal with? It's a good, bad thing again. That until I see your side of the argument, we're going to be at odds forever. Nobody's going to be continuous. Like, for instance, war. The people who've gone through it can't talk about it because they're traumatized and can't remember it, or they just don't want to stir it up. And the people who haven't been through it don't want to hear about it. And it's like animal rights, for instance. It's a thing of making icky stuff conscious that we don't worry about animal rights. It's all going out there in the factory where they're chopping them up in an assembly line, but we don't have to look at it or know about it or anything. It's the I don't want to deal with it part of it that has to do with growing up. It has to do perhaps with understanding more about what people are about.
Actually, what you said brings something up to me that I never thought in this particular way. One of the things that I include in the seven areas that we could discuss is ideology. And that we're all, there's hardly anybody in the world who's not ideological, but there are certain things that they don't have a worldview that focuses on some things, and part of the focusing on some things is to not focus on others. And so that helps say, as well as that there's academic specialties and people have specialties, but it's also that a good part of the function that we have is to develop viewpoints, and that part of developing those viewpoints is to dismiss or ignore others. And so why the hell is that? That part I haven't gotten to yet, but that's then integral to the problem that I'm confronting, which is even, the four figures that I mentioned have perspectives and things that leave some important things out. There's no way in the world I'm going to be as inclusive as I'm trying to be. There's no way in the world I'm going to do that because I certainly am oriented towards certain things and not others. And part of all this is that we all have certain aptitudes and don't have other aptitudes. Mm-hmm. But another part of it is there's always something about each of us that not only has things we move towards out of inclination and ability, but there's also a lot we don't want to deal with that's part of, that also might be some important approach. There's some hostility there. We're eliminating them, we're denigrating them, we're omitting them because we can't fully, there are very few of us who can fully embrace a wider variety of things without it undermining or challenging some of the things we hold most dear. So,
I just recorded that for you.
So that's something that I can add when I get to that. Though everybody's partial. And there are a variety of reasons for that, because we live by our belief systems.
So you can talk about that. Yeah.
That's what I'm right. That's right. That's what I'm going to do right there.
I don't know about that.
Please go pull out, okay?
Yeah, just responding to what you brought up, I think that's pretty interesting, you know. What has always been left out? And I was thinking about the poem, Search for the Holy Grail, 1,000 years old, first really great poem. And I say, what's it about? And they're still making movies about it. Steven Spielberg makes lots of movies about it, right? So what? Search for the Holy Grail, right? Well, that's great. You know, it's a beautiful thing. It's a chalice. It's a life-giving. But the real, if you read the whole poem, it's about two things. It's about the thing that was never talked about. So when he went into the castle, the young knight, Percival, he sees... He was told, don't ask questions about anything. He goes into the banquet with the Fisher King, and two things occur. Some boys bring out a bloody lance, and they walk across the floor, and then some girls bring out a beautiful chalice. Right? Then he proceeds to try to find the chalice his whole life, and at the end he's deeply depressed, talks to a priest, and the priest said, well, you missed everything. You didn't ask the question initially. You didn't ask it. Total denial, right? And every poem and every film and every book based on that is always the same. It's always about the good thing. We're looking for the great thing. And not really about the other. So if you see any illustrations of the first poem, right, you see two things, not one. You see the bloody, disgusting lance, and then you see the beautiful food and the chalice, right? So it's the same thing of like, it's human denial of a thing you really don't want to think about at all. And then this is 1,000 years of other artists. The Holy Grail, it's a great thing. We can find this thing. So just in response to what you said, I think that's very interesting. Yeah.
Nadia?
I was just thinking that, you know, the great thing psychoanalyst, you know, they all built their theory around their personal thing that they were trying to figure out.
Right.
And so, of course, they're just explaining their particular, you know, theory and view, and everyone could relate to it because a lot of it's just the human condition, but with their particular brand of experience. So I think yours, you know, you'll convey your way of seeing it, and it will focus on that. That's
going to
be good enough.
So. And a real contribution.
Ruth? No. Okay. How about Joyce? No? Okay. All right. Go ahead. No, I don't believe it.
So what are you thinking? What are your questions?
I asked that question and it's being answered. Okay. No, it's fun.
The only thing that I was thinking about hearing all this is it is going to be helpful for me to see from all these people that I'm quoting, who's the one who really helped me understand this plan? Who from all these people gave me a hint?
Okay.
And that's the idea of, you know, from all the things, okay. All the people that you're reading, quoting. Are there some of them who really said, oh, I think I can't understand the way they kill, or did not help me, or did not talk about enough?
So I like the Pascal quote, and I like the Montaigne quote, but it's also, you know, and I was dealing with a lot of people, but I must say a lot of it's just me. I mean, Hegel. I mean, in certain ways, I think, I mean, I come out of certain conditions. I spend more time looking into Freud than anything else. But it's sort of like, oh, no one's done this. No one's tried to put together this. No one, you know, we're talking about killing the way that I'm going to kill. Attachment is another story. How we've risen from hunter-gatherers to who we are, like both of them. But, like, one of the things, so some of it's
need, it's never just like I keep reading and reading. But so it's been like one person from this discipline, one person, you know what I mean? So I don't know if I can say fully answer that. You know, coming across that Montaigne book that I mentioned, you know, I then read his complete work, which is amazing. You know who he influenced a lot? William Shakespeare. That's another person. And Chuck Berry.
And that's where the humor would come in. You put in Chuck Berry, you know.
I can't write humor.
I saw some puns in here. Pretty funny.
I don't think you have to put that kind of humor.
I don't have the gift for that. I don't have the gift for that. But I mean, you know, as a teacher, having some humor was always a big deal. I could always tell if a class was going to go well by the humor. If they got my humor. If they didn't get my humor, it's going to be a lot of work. And I had one class toward the end of my teaching career, which was this Nature Be Human class, that whatever it was, and that old, I was like a riot. It was very serious, we had a lot of intense discussion, but I never have been funnier in any class than I was in that class. And it was like, and so it's like, you know it, you do one thing, and then it just keeps building and building and building. Okay. I want to say one other thing. I often say to Paul, a lot of times when I have these forum meetings, that the focus of the meeting turns away from the topic. Yeah. And it can be very interesting and rewarding, but isn't always on the paper. Well, this one clearly was.
Because you're doing something very important, very human, for all of us. It needs to be written in a more human way. Getting away from listening and dialogue with these different people, all these wonderful ideas that have been suggested, but you being in it directly, you're
the major voice.
Yeah.
That's
good. As a moderator, I'll say anything. I just call people. I don't allow myself, I don't know what we talk about when I have to say. I think you could be the next Jay Leno.
In other words, I'm barking up the wrong tree. No. Is that what you're saying?
A lot of trees you bark up.
And Jock says that to me regularly. So I don't know if I would want to be Jay Leno, but you know, I can think of other people. But Jock says that to me regularly.
It's somebody else I can't repeat because a couple of I'll tell you.
So Jock will call me on the phone, I'll say something, and he'll start laughing.
All right, I confess. I call him a pisser. You brought that out of me.
Well, I want to thank you again for bringing all this, allowing us to do this to you with good intentions.
Right.
Okay. I'm feeling like we have. Yeah, we're ready to go eat. For those who can, and a great appreciation for Ken, for Jacques, for Eugenia, who will share it with others. Thank you.